Good evening. I'm Lorraine Kostu-Zipak of the New York Times, and I'm so thrilled to bring you this very special Times Talks with Andrea Bocelli. Just days before his incredible gift to New York City, his free concert in Central Park with the New York Philharmonic. With over 65 million albums sold and countless awards, Mr. Bocelli has proved himself to be one of the world's great tenors. As his duet partner Celine Dion said, "If God would have a singing voice, he would sound a lot like Andrea Bocelli." You will meet this extraordinary talent in a minute, but first, it is my great pleasure to introduce to you tonight's moderator. Since joining the Times in 1995, she has written about everything from cultural institutions to architecture to performing arts, as well as media and city news. Before joining the Times, she was an associate producer with ABC News and a reporter for the New York Observer. And now, without further delay, please join me in welcoming New York Times reporter Robin Pogrebin and our very special guest, Andrea Bocelli.
Welcome, everyone. Yes. It's exciting to be here with Andrea.
And it's
just a treat to have him in New York and in this kind of a pretty intimate setting, given that he's going to be in Central Park singing in the Great Lawn on Thursday. So, Andrea, your father had two dreams for you, to sing in America and especially to sing in New York. And on Thursday, you're giving a free concert in Central Park with the New York Philharmonic, conducted by Alan Gilbert and featuring Celine Dion, Tony Bennett, Nicola Benedetti, and Brian Terfel, among others. Why was this a dream of your father's, and how does it feel to have it come true?
First of all, let me say something in English. I'm sorry, I will speak Italian for many reasons. First of all, because my English is not enough. It's horrible English. I'm trying to improve it a little bit, but probably I come in America not so often. I have to do it more. And second one also because I'm a little bit tired because in this evening we had 3 hours of rehearsals with the New York Philharmonic, so I prefer to speak in my language just to try to say something a little bit more interesting.
Mm-hmm. Okay?
So, sorry for this. Anyway, sì, mio padre aveva questi due sogni che riuscisse a cantare in America, e in particolare a New York. Probabilmente non ha mai sognato un palco come quello che mi vedrà protagonista dopodomani, né avrebbe mai sognato di vedermi affiancare da artisti di questo talento, di questa levatura, come quelli che ha appena citato, da Brian Terfel a Tony Bennett e Celine Dion e tutti gli altri, David Foster. Quindi penso che mio padre sarà molto felice di questo.
Yes, my dad had two dreams. And the first one was to see me sing in the United States and specifically in New York. But I don't think he could have ever imagined for me to sing on a stage as big as the one where I'm going to be singing the day after tomorrow. And I think also he could have never imagined to see me sing with so many talented artists such as Brian Terfel, Tony Bennett, Celine Dion, David Foster, and so on. So I think that if he were here, he would be very, very happy.
Aggiungo tutto questo con molto rispetto per le idee di tutti, insomma, che indubbiamente questo cammino che io ho fatto nella mia carriera è un cammino straordinario, perché neppure io avrei mai pensato che potesse succedermi tutto questo. Ma credo fermamente che in queste cose, in questo genere di avventure, ci sia sempre dietro la mano del buon Dio, perché sono sicuro di poter dire che con le mie sole forze sarei andato assai poco lontano. Sicuramente non sarei arrivato in America.
Well, and I say what I'm about to say with respect towards the ideas of everyone, but I believe that what happened to me in my career, in my walks of life, is quite extraordinary. I would have never ever thought that something like this could have happened to me. And I believe that this could have never happened without God on my side. Because with my forces, I would have never reached this far, especially I would have never gotten to sing in the United States.
When you are rehearsing for a performance like this, and it's outdoors and it's huge, I know you have done some outdoor performing. What is the preparation that makes it different? Is there a way in which you need to think about your voice differently when you're in front of that many people and you're preparing, given that even you're rehearsing, from what I understand, in Avery Fisher Hall, which is not the same?
No, la preparazione per un concerto, per un'opera, per qualunque genere di cose che si fanno davanti a un pubblico che dedica il suo tempo e il risultato delle sue fatiche per venire ad ascoltarti è sempre la stessa. Cioè, occorre comunque sapere che bisogna, salendo su un palco, bisogna avere la coscienza a posto, di aver fatto tutto il possibile per poter dare il meglio di sé. Ora, in un caso come questo, qui a Central Park, non ci si può nascondere dietro un dito, ovviamente la situazione è un po' diversa, soprattutto perché questo è un concerto per la città, per il popolo, per la gente di New York e, insomma, per tutti quegli americani e non solo americani che da tanti anni mi hanno fatto sentire con forza il loro grande affetto e la loro stima. Quindi è necessario cercare di fare veramente una cosa speciale e lasciare anche un ricordo bello attraverso la registrazione di quello che sarà poi il CD e il DVD. Complicato, mi spiace. Very long.
Well, the preparations for any concert, be it an opera or any other performance, is really always the same, because you have a public, an audience that spent their time and effort to be there with you. And so you always have to have your conscience clear that you've done your best in order to be there. But in Central Park, we cannot hide. We need to say that this is a different situation. This is a concert that was done, was organized for the city, for the people of New York, for all those Americans that have always shown me a lot of affection and a lot, they have given me a lot of their esteem. And therefore, it has to be something special. And also, I hope that it will keep some beautiful memories thanks to the CD and the DVD.
Probabilmente è giusto anche scendere un po' nel concreto e spiegare un po' cosa significa preparare un concerto, quali sono i sacrifici o comunque le fatiche che bisogna fare. Allora, bisogna confessare subito che per questo concerto praticamente ho passato il mese d'agosto, che è un mese di vacanza, un po' per tutti, togliendo il vino, togliendo la pasta. Yeah. I'm Italian. Without pasta, it's terrible. Without wine, without pasta, it's an horrible holiday for me. And and studying, because in this concert I will try to perform four or five songs that I sing for the first time. So, and in English. That's complicated.
Do you want to add what he...
Yes. At the beginning he said, okay, so let's be practical and let me tell you exactly what kind of sacrifices had to be done in preparation for this performance. During the entire month of August, which you probably know in Italy is usually vacation time, I had to give up completely wine and pasta.
My son, Amos, the first one, was in Los Angeles. He has been in Los Angeles for 1 month. And coming back in New York after a month, he told me, Daddy, you are thinner now. Okay, it's good.
Pasta is bad for your voice?
No. The problem is not pasta. The problem is the fat.
The weight.
You know? The weight.
You have said that opera was always and remains your first love. You have described it as your true passion and your destiny. Can you tell us why, and that even though you have become known for popular songs as well, opera remains primary for you?
Yeah. I don't know, because since when I was a child, in school, in church, at the parties of my friends, in my house, everywhere somebody asked me to sing. It was boring for me at the time because sometimes I was tired, sometimes I was playing with my friends with the balls. Ball?
Yes,
with the ball.
Not the balls.
Andrea, your English is great. Don't worry.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I remember many times arrived at home, friends or relatives, and my father, my mother, come on, sing something for us every time. And I thought probably it's my destiny. I don't know. And it was true for this reason. And opera, because since I heard an opera singer, first time I tried to make imitation of this. Because I like this huge volume, this beautiful intonation, the big expression of a tenor or baritone or something. Mm-hmm. It's beautiful, I like it. There's no why.
You have said in at least one interview that you never really enjoyed singing popular music, even the romantic, almost operatic ballads that have made you famous. Do you still feel that way? And can you talk about what your views are about popular music these days? I know that at one point when you were growing up, you listened to Stevie Wonder and the Beatles. So, you know, what is your attitude towards it now?
Ho scoperto la musica pop, l'ho scoperta con piacere quando ero già grandicello, avevo già quasi 20 anni. E per ragioni futili, diciamo così, durante il periodo dell'università ho iniziato a suonare nei piano bar. E naturalmente in questo tipo di locali non si può cantare l'opera. E allora ho dovuto cominciare ad ascoltare qualcosa di diverso e ho scoperto che era comunque molto interessante. È stato un po' come imparare una lingua nuova per me, no? E da quel giorno, ma anche lì forse c'era un segno del destino, perché è stato comunque un passo che dopo mi è servito durante tutti questi anni per cantare tutte quelle cose che poi voi avete ascoltato.
Well, I actually have to say that I discovered pop when I was rather old. I was already in my 20s. And the reason was that during the university, I started to sing in piano bars. And over there, you could hardly sing opera. You had to sing something different. And that's why I started listening to pop music. And I discovered it was quite interesting. It was a little bit like learning a new language for me. But maybe there was destiny, you know. It's something that served me well and prepared me to sing for you the songs that you like so much.
When I was a child in school, for example, sometimes I sang opera, no, for my friends, but they teased me, no, because they didn't like it, and they told me, why do you shout? Stop.
You have said that you prefer recordings to live performances, that you suffered from stage fright. Yeah. Concerts, you once said, are for me a terror always. Singing at home before friends is not difficult, and behind a recording microphone, I am almost tranquil. But from the stage, an audience is for me like a monster. Now, this is hard for many of us who see you as a professional performer who is so at ease on stage to understand and believe. Do you still feel this way? Do you still get nervous before you go on? I did notice you were playing the piano back there before you came out, which I'm told helps you relax. So I just wonder, do you still have that kind of profound fear before you go out there?
I'm very nervous always, but I'm nervous when I have to go on stage to sing, not to speak. To speak, I'm quiet, I'm tranquil. Yes, I'm nervous because I would like to give always all my best, and that's impossible, because every time something happens, no? And if I go to listen to my performance after, I'm never content.
No.
Never. So I decide don't listen to and stop. For this reason, it's Carter. I prefer to record because there I can project every note that I do, and if something is not good, we do again. Mm-hmm. And finally, okay, listen to my recording in studio. I have to say, honestly, I am quite happy. Instead of in life, I would like to do always better, and it's impossible because everyone makes mistake, and it's impossible to be perfect, and I hate it. I would like to be.
Your voice has been featured on the television series The Sopranos, Barilla Pasta commercials, and ads for the Bellagio Resort. Mm-hmm. How does it feel to have your voice become a part of pop culture? Are you comfortable with it? Was it hard to get used to? Are you open to those opportunities?
Ma io ho un po' paura che proprio per il motivo che ormai si sente i miei dischi, la mia voce un po' ovunque, c'è un po' il timore che piano piano diventi fastidiosa, no? Che a noi che sì, diventi fastidiosa. Io spero che questo non accada.
Well, I have a little bit of a fear that because my records and my voice is heard everywhere, little by little it becomes annoying. And I do hope it doesn't happen.
C'è il rischio che ci sia questa reazione, no? Ancora, nel senso, basta.
You know, there is a risk that people react that way, that they say, stop, stop, please.
I know that you don't like the term crossover superstar, but I also wonder why that isn't a point of pride for you, that you are reaching masses of people instead of just opera cognoscenti. And when you recorded a CD of Verdi's arias, for example, with Zubin Mehta conducting the Israeli Philharmonic, it made it onto the pop charts, selling 557,000 copies. And your first opera recording of Puccini's La Bohème sold 37,000 copies. Why isn't it good to be crossing over?
Crossover è un concetto, a mio avviso, non condivisibile, perché significa un po' mischiare le cose. Io ritengo, ho sempre sostenuto che ogni linguaggio deve essere rispettato, al massimo. Vuol dire che se si canta l'opera bisogna rispettare, conoscere, studiare e rispettare il linguaggio dell'opera. Quando si canta una canzone si deve immaginare un linguaggio assolutamente diverso. Altrimenti è come parlare l'inglese mescolandolo con l'italiano o viceversa, no? Alla fine si crea una lingua che dice tutto e niente. Per questa ragione non amo questo termine, crossover. A me piace il rispetto dei linguaggi, la purezza del linguaggio.
You got that?
Well, yes. I don't like the concept of crossover because I don't think it can be agreed to. Because it implies the idea of a mix, of a mixture. I believe that each language needs to be respected in its own way. Opera needs to be known, studied, and respected. If instead you sing a song, a pop song, the language is different. And if you speak about crossover, it's as if you were speaking English and mixing it with Italian. You're saying everything, but you're really saying nothing. That's why I don't like the idea of crossover. I am for purity, for keeping each language in its own domain.
Voglio aggiungere che io sempre ho molto rispetto per chi crede in questo genere, in questo modo di far musica e lo fa al meglio delle sue possibilità ed ha un pubblico che lo segue e che ama questo genere di cose. Dico che non va bene per me.
But let me add this. I have a lot of respect for people who do that and have a public that loves them and follows them. I just say it's not for me.
Okay. We constantly hear about aging audiences and declining subscriptions, that opera is considered a dying art. Do you partially feel responsible for keeping it alive, and do you worry about the art form?
Ma io credo che non credo che questo sia vero, nel senso che i teatri, grazie a Dio, sono sempre pieni. E noi in Italia si dice così, scherzando, con una battuta poco elegante, insomma, che bisogna aspettare che qualcuno muoia per fare un abbonamento, no? Perché non ce ne sono. E questo significa che c'è ancora una grande amore per l'opera e ci sono tanti ragazzi che vanno all'opera, si appassionano a questo genere musicale. Io credo che il problema sia fisico, nel senso che i teatri contengono poche persone. Non si può immaginare di fare l'opera in un grande stadio, così come si fa un concerto rock o come si gioca una partita di calcio. L'opera è di casa in teatro, dove possano entrare 1.000-2.000 persone, in un teatro di tradizione, così. E il secondo aspetto, tanto Maria sta prendendo appunto, il secondo aspetto è legato alla diffusione di questo genere musicale, perché purtroppo l'opera non funziona in televisione. L'opera ha bisogno di essere ascoltata in teatro. E questo è un grosso svantaggio, perché perché la comunicazione la comunicazione oggi avviene attraverso la televisione. Ciò nonostante, i teatri sono pieni, i giovani vengono volentieri a teatro e io credo che sarà sempre così perché l'opera è il paradiso della musica.
You have to write, you have to write a book now. Eh?
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't believe that what you said is true, because actually the theaters are always full. In fact, in Italy, we used to say something that may not sound very elegant, that if you want to get a subscription into in a theater in Italy, you need to wait for someone to die. Otherwise, you can't get one. And that's because there's always love for opera. And there are more and more youths that are becoming passionate about opera and go to the theater. I believe that the issues are two. The first one is has to do with logistics. The theaters are small. They're not as big as stadiums where you can go for a game or for a rock concert. In theaters, you can seat, in the traditional theaters, 1,000, 2,000 people. And the second issue is that opera doesn't play well on TV. And nowadays, communication happens on video. And therefore, this is a disadvantage for opera. But nevertheless, even with all of this, the youth loves opera, because opera is really the paradise of music.
He has reissued this book, his memoir. It had come out, and now he has added 11 years of experience to it. I wonder kind of what has gone into this book now that wasn't there before, and kind of what did you have to say by reissuing it this month?
Well, I've written this book very quickly because my idea was that my father could read it before to go. And later I tried to fix all the small things that I wanted to change. And with the occasion, I tried to include 10 years more of the protagonist of the book, Amos, because I want to remember that this book is basically
It's a story.
Story. Very close to my life, very, very close to my biography, but it's however, a story. So I try to include, to continue the story with the last 10 years of Amos, the protagonist of the story.
Fiction, rather.
Yes.
Fiction,
yeah.
I think. Fiction.
Can you explain to us why you chose to tell it through Amos instead of through Andrea?
Because, I don't know, because Amos, it's a beautiful name. And it's also the name of a man, a great man, that has been very close to me for many, many years. And in this sense, it's like a tribute for him.
You were going to be a lawyer, which is kind of amazing, and you even got a degree at the University of Pisa, and you worked for a brief time as a court-appointed defense attorney. What were you thinking by doing that? And how did you find your way back to singing?
Quando mi sono accorto che non potevo difendere cantando, ho pensato bene di cantare senza difendere nessuno.
When I realized that I could not defend anyone without singing, I decided I better not defend anyone.
That's a good answer.
Buona risposta.
Diplomatic, because I don't know why I did it. I don't know why I stopped it. Because basically, the life it's a strange adventure, no? Nobody know the future, so I've never tried to know my future, and I accept all the things that it's happened, are happened in my life. That's all.
But your parents supported you.
Yeah.
They didn't feel as if you needed to be a lawyer to have a real life. They didn't feel that singing was not a legitimate pursuit. Is that right? Did you feel like you could be a singer if you wanted to be when you were young?
No, they said me always, you are free and you can do every kind of thing you want to do. But before, you have to study, because the singing is like a difficult challenge. So you can try if you want, but before you have to study, and for the moment, sing for us.
Your mother has said that when you were a baby, you would stop crying whenever you heard classical music.
That's true. It's a true story.
Do you have a memory of classical music soothing you? And
no, because at that time, I was 6 months old, and I don't remember. But the story, I think, is true, because I cried very often, and when I could listen to the music, immediately I stopped to cry, because it was my destiny.
And yet you had no formal training for a long time. Can you kind of describe those beginnings of kind of when this became clearly your path in life? And, you know, given that this was not a musical family you were coming from, and from what I understand, you were taking instruments, lessons in piano, but not singing until you were older.
I think, as I said before, I stopped to cry always, listen to the music, because it was my way. It was my way to say, let me study, let me sing, let me study the music, probably. But yeah, in my family, my father was completely out tune, completely. He had a voice very strong, especially when he was angry with me. But absolutely, come si dice stonato, out of tune. from the family of my mother, instead of, there were musicians, not professional, but good musician, and probably I ereditato, come si dice,
I inherited.
Inherited, too difficult. this passion from her family, yeah. But I began to study the piano when I was 8 years old, and I did it for many years. Honestly, with not with great results. Also because I was very lazy, very lazy. And but when I was 20 years old, honestly, I could play not very well, but everything. I began to study for singing later, because I was so stupid that I thought that it was impossible to study the singing, no? I thought it was like a talent, or you have it or you don't have it. And this is because I had never met a good coach, good teacher. When I met my first coach, I realized that I was completely fuori strada.
I didn't understand anything.
Well, my teacher, when heard my voice for the first time, I sang for him, and at the end he said to me, "Listen, you have a beautiful voice, but you do exactly the contrary, the things that you should have to do." And I said, "Okay, it's a good news, because I can, it means that I can improve." And probably it was true.
When you, Franco Corelli was an early hero of yours. Can you describe how you discovered him and what it was like to sing for him for the first time?
I discovered his voice because in my house there was a girl,
una ragazza che lavorava in casa con noi.
There was a girl that was working in my home.
Ed era una grande fan di Franco Corelli.
And she was a great fan of Franco Corelli.
E un giorno è arrivata a casa con un giornale, lei, e lesse questo articolo che si intitolava così, Strabilia alla Scala Franco Corelli. No?
And one day she came home with this newspaper and there was an article and the title was Franco Corelli at La Scala amazes everyone.
Yeah. E poi mi disse, guarda che è un bellissimo uomo, bisogna che tu ti faccia comprare un disco. Io non ero molto interessato al fatto che fosse bello, naturalmente. Però mi incuriosì questa cosa e di lì a poco mi feci regalare il primo disco di Corelli. E fu come, non so, fu un amore a prima vista.
Well, and she told me, you know, he's really a very handsome man. You must have somebody give you a record of his song, of his voice, as soon as possible. Well, of course, I was not really interested in the fact that he was a handsome man, but still, I had somebody give me one of his records soon after, and I have to say I was quite impressed, and it was love at first sight, at first hear.
Io credo che da quel giorno sia nato qualcosa di nuovo dentro di me, perché alla passione per l'opera, la passione così per le voci si è aggiunta proprio una specie di mania per questo cantante. E da quel giorno ho cominciato a cercare di fare un po', di cantare alla sua maniera, di fare quello che faceva lui. E a sognare di conoscerlo.
Well, from then on, I have to say something new started in me, and to the passion for voices that I had up to then, it was added this new passion for this particular singer. I tried to imitate him, I tried to sing like he was, and from then on, it was really, I wanted to meet him.
La sua voce mi colpiva così profondamente che cominciai a accettare anche l'idea che fosse bello. Cominciò a piacermi questa cosa.
His voice was really touching me so deeply that from then on I started really to consider the idea that he might be a handsome man and accepting the idea.
Poi ho avuto la grande fortuna di conoscerlo, di frequentarlo, di studiare con lui e a volte lo raggiungevo nella sua casa di Milano o a Cortina d'Ampezzo in montagna e stavo magari una settimana con lui e stavamo tutto il giorno, parlavamo di canto.
And that from afterwards, I was lucky enough to get to meet him and to study with him. Sometimes I would go and meet him in his apartment in Milan, some other times in Cortina d'Ampezzo on the mountains. And I would spend, say, a week with him. And every day we would spend all day talking about singing.
Questo è successo fino a che lui ci ha lasciato, insomma. E è continuato anche nel periodo in cui io avevo cominciato a cantare e ero diventato famoso, insomma, in Europa, prima in Europa, ecco. E siccome io ero così interessato, maniaco di tutto quello che potevo carpire dalla sua arte, che dopo aver parlato di canto tutto il giorno, io lo invitavo a cena e così continuavamo a parlare di canto fino a notte inoltrata.
And this went on all the time until he left us. And at that time I had started to sing, and I was even becoming famous in Europe first. And I was still so passionate about him that I wanted to get as much as possible from him, to learn as much as possible from him, that after we had spent the whole day talking about singing, I would invite him for dinner, and we would keep talking until well into the night.
E poi a un certo punto smisi invece di invitarla a cena per una cosa così, in un certo senso triste e anche comica sotto certi aspetti, perché io nel frattempo ero diventato famoso, come dicevo, lui non lo era più. Perché il mondo fa presto a dimenticare, questa è una cosa molto triste. Allora accadeva che uscendo di casa per andare a cena, è accaduto spesso che qualcuno mi fermasse e mi dicesse: maestro, mi fa un autografo per favore, oppure facciamo una foto insieme, no? E io diventavo di tutti i colori, ero imbarazzatissimo, perché il maestro era lui, non ero io. E io non potevo e non riuscivo a spiegare a queste persone che io ero piccola cosa in confronto a lui. E avrei voluto che loro trascurassero me e si mettessero davanti a lui e ricordassero quello che per tanti anni ha regalato al mondo intero.
I at some point though I stopped inviting him for dinner for something that is actually a sad but also maybe funny reason. As I said before, I had started to become famous, and he was not famous any longer, because as you know, the world forgets quickly.